In this video, we'll compare gRPC and REST side by side. We'll measure how long it takes to serialize and deserialize protobuf and JSON messages by using Prometheus. As well as we'll record the latency of each request, traffic, CPU, and memory usage of the applications deployed in Kubernetes. We'll use Terraform to create infrastructure in AWS, including the EKS cluster from scratch. Then deploy REST and gRPC apps and expose them to the clients within the VPC using a private Nginx ingress controller. First of all, let's compare the size of serialized messages. In this simple test, we'll take the Golang struct and convert it to bytes, using serialized JSON and serialized protobuf functions and saving them to the disk. Let's run serializer slash main.go and compare the output. We have event.json, which is 1.2 kilobytes, and event.pb, which is almost half the size of the JSON file. If you check the content of the files, the JSON is simply converted to the string with escape characters. Now, if you get the protobuf message, it's not as human readable as JSON, but it's definitely much smaller, which should play a role in overall performance of gRPC and reduce the latency of the requests. In my GitHub repo, you can find a Terraform and Ansible to reproduce this setup. Sometimes you want to create a separate Kubernetes node group for ingress pods to improve stability of the cluster. You can use taints on the node group with no execute effect. Then, when you deploy the Helm chart, you need to have several set statements to tolerate the taint. We have the key, value, operator, and effect. Also, you can upgrade AWS Classic Load Balancer to Network Load Balancer by using Load Balancer type annotation. Now, let's go ahead and run the second test to compare serialization for each message type. We use Prometheus summary metric type to record it. In the first graph, we measure P99, which represents 99% of all requests completed under specified time duration. You can notice that on average, it takes half of the time to serialize the protobuf message to bytes than JSON. The values are in microseconds. A similar result for deserialization when we take the bytes and convert them back to the Golang struct. In this case, the difference is even bigger. Now, for the final test, we send a request from the client to each service, REST and gRPC. Then the service returns the response with the event object hardcoded in the app. This event object is one of my previous tutorials. In the idle state, the memory and CPU usage of the REST application is higher. Let's go ahead and run the test. To generate load, I use K6 tool developed by Grafana team. First, we slowly scale virtual users to 50 during the 5-minute interval, then increase the users to 100, and finally, for the last 5 minutes, just increase them to 150. Apparently, the size of the payload does not play a role here. You can see that CPU and memory usage of the gRPC server are higher, as well as the latency, which really surprised me. I always thought that gRPC is a gold standard, at least for latency. We're not comparing client or server-side streaming here. Even from the official documentation, they recommend using simple RPC calls since it's much easier to load balance when the load increases. gRPC also has lots of other features, such as retries, load balancing, and many more. And it's much more convenient to work with gRPC stubs in the code with typed functions. But when it comes to the speed, it may be not the best option on the market right now. I have a playlist with other benchmarks that you may find interesting. For example, Nginx versus Apache, Golang versus Rust, and more. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.